Please join me in welcoming Dr. David Coletto, giving this year's Paul Vito Lecture.
Well, thanks, Andrea, for that very warm welcome. I don't think my bio has my age, but you're all wondering, how old am I? How is it possible to have a PhD from the great University of Calgary? I am 34. I am not 18, although sometimes in Ontario I still get carded at our local LCBO. So they call me Doogie at work, even though I'm the boss, so you can tell you the kind of workplace you're in. It's great to be here, and I want to thank the organizers of this conference. I think it's fabulous that that there's an amazing student conference that brings academics, researchers from all over the country, internationally, here to Winnipeg. I also want to thank, and I'm incredibly impressed with this amazing bookstore. And so I encourage you all on your way out, buy a book. It's amazing that we have an independent bookstore like this here in Ottawa. We have nothing like this. So we have chapters everywhere. So support your local independent bookstores. I think this is great. On to what I'm going to talk about today. I am a pollster. Depending on who I tell that to, I usually get mixed reactions. Either I get hisses and boos, none from the audience, good yet, or blank stares. Because usually when I stand in front of an audience and I'm about to tell them I'm going to go through 55 slides of data, I usually can't fill a room like this. So it's very exciting. But what I'm going to try to do today, as Andrea said, is talk a little bit about, I've been doing this now for 6 years. I have the privilege of being able to interview hundreds of thousands of Canadians every year in a range of topics, some of which I never thought I'd learn about doing what I do. But I'm going to focus mainly on what I think was a remarkable, fabulous federal election that we just had. Not because of the outcome itself. As a pollster, I try not to be partisan in any real way, but simply because of what happened and how a country came together and the dynamics of that campaign shifted. And it was unpredictable, and I think the result surprised many, although we often will, particularly the commentators in Ottawa, the pundits, will always say, I knew this outcome was going to happen. Well, nobody really knew that the Liberals were going to go from 30 seats to over 180, to go from 19% of the vote to almost 40% of the vote. And most interesting, although we never talk about it, is they won the popular vote in all but two provinces across the country, including here in Manitoba. That's a remarkable turn of events. And so what I'm hoping to do today is shed some light on the data that we collected over the election and give you my perspective on what I think happened and what it means for the next 4 years and the next 10 years in terms of where the public is and what they expect of the Liberal government. So I start with, so this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to go through some data from the 2015 election, and then I'll talk a little bit about five lessons that I think we can take from it. There's probably 20 lessons, but I only have 45 minutes, so I'm going to try to keep my remarks in that time frame. So if we start with national vote intention, right, the ballot question. This is our tracking, you can see here, since March 2014. Okay, so the red line are the Liberals, the blue is Conservative, orange is New Democrats. Those lines and that color we're going to use throughout the day. And you can see that we have actually seen a remarkable amount of change in people's stated voting preferences over the course of a year and a half, right, since March, since spring of 2014. At the early stage of 2014 and into the fall, the Liberals had a significant lead over the Conservatives. Then the Conservatives picked up some ground on the Liberals. Then we saw around the budget, the federal budget, at least in our tracking, a spike for the Conservatives after they showered us with a number of goodies and tax credits, which quickly subsided as I think people realized that that's not enough. And we, in two provinces to the west of here, we saw the New Democrats get elected in Alberta, which coincided, I believe, with the rise of the New Democrats. What's fascinating is, at the start of the campaign, what was remarkable of this campaign is that basically the three parties were within 5 points of each other in most polling that we saw. At one point during the campaign, all three of the main parties were both in first and in third at some point, although rarely did more than 5 or 10 points separate those parties. So for most of the campaign, and all the polling that we saw, regardless of the firm, it was highly competitive, really until the very end, when we saw the Liberals move ahead quickly, and the New Democrats fall down. So the question that I'm going to try to address today is talk a little bit about what happened. And I think while we always talk about one election campaign, what was really happening when you look at from the election from a public opinion perspective and the polling data that we have, is that we really had two campaigns. The first campaign was what usually happens when you have an incumbent government, and that is whether that incumbent, in this case the Conservatives, deserve to be reelected, and whether there was a credible alternative waiting in the wings to take over. Okay? You have to have both of those conditions met for a government to change. The government has to be unpopular, or people have to believe there's time for a change, but there also has to be a credible alternative. We've had many a provincial election up until 2015 in which relatively unpopular incumbent governments had been reelected. Christy Clark in British Columbia, Dalton McGuinty and Kathleen Wynne in Ontario. Even Alison Redford in 2012 in Alberta started that campaign, and all the pollsters thought right to the end that they were going to lose, but somehow pulled that off. So many an incumbent has won despite the fact that large numbers of voters felt that it was time for a change, and in part because you needed a credible alternative. But the second campaign that really focused most of the attention in the later part, once it was clear that the Conservatives might have a difficult time winning again, was which alternative was the best one to replace Stephen Harper. And this was a unique feature of Canadian elections. And no point, I think, really, at one point during the 1988 election, there was some thought that Ed Broughton might be able to pull it off, but at no point was it as clear that the New Democrats could actually win the election or that the Liberals could win the election at the same time. So let's focus first on the first campaign. And since early 2015, we tracked a question in which we asked people how much they were looking for change. So we asked them, do you agree or which of these statements comes closest to your view? And at the final weekend of the campaign, in our final survey, 60% of Canadians said they definitely believed it was time for a change. Another 15% said they'd like change, but it's not that important to them. Okay? So 3/4 of Canadians across the country said, kind of enough's enough, right? With a large 60% majority saying, not just enough's enough, but we definitely want this government gone, okay? And when we look at this trend over time, and we go back to April 2015, we see that on the one hand, it's fairly stable, right? Not a significantly sharp slope, but a steady growth in the intensity for that desire of change from 50% in April 2015 to 60% by the end of the campaign, okay? So if we're gonna take one lesson from this already, it's that the Conservatives were not able to change opinion among themselves, okay? That in fact, you know, while they improved the blue line, which is the Conservatives definitely deserve to be reelected, that hit at one point only 14% of Canadians believe that, by the end of the campaign, they were able to harden and mobilize their base to 20%. That's a very difficult position in which to win an election, particularly one in which they were looking to win a majority. And one of the reasons why I think, for many, it was surprising that the Conservatives were not as competitive, at least in the early stages of the campaign, as they were, was because perceptions around the economy, while they had deteriorated, if you ask Canadians to describe the state of the economy, the red line are the percentage of people who said either very good or good. The green line was very good or good. The red line is poor or very poor. You can see that there was a significant shift in a month between July and August. And if you remember back to the early days of the campaign, particularly in August, there was a lot of signals to Canadians that the economy maybe wasn't as strong as we thought, right? The dollar dropped, the price of oil dropped, you had the Shanghai stock market take that tumble, and there were lots of doubts about how secure the future was and how effective perhaps the Conservatives were on what many thought was their strongest asset, which was their management of the economy. Despite the fact that almost 2/3 of Canadians said the economy was doing poor or very poor, and you can see that that persisted throughout the campaign, 40% of Canadians still said, things aren't that bad, right? That's enough for a government to win a majority. In fact, that's around the percentage of the vote of the Conservatives got in 2011. So there was still an opportunity for them to do well. And when you ask Canadians to actually rate the performance of the government in terms of economic management, we found that, again, not a majority, but a large number, almost over 4 out of 10 Canadians said they actually did a pretty good job managing the economy, including a number of people who weren't planning to vote for them. So when James Carville, infamous, famous advisor to Bill Clinton, said it's the economy, stupid, one of the lessons I will take from this election is it's not always about the economy. And I think this was one election where the Conservatives hoped to make it about it, but ultimately failed, and I'll show you some examples of that, because the data suggests that a large enough segment of the population believed the Conservatives were doing just fine on managing that issue. Some more evidence to suggest that at least this election could have been about the economy, but the Conservatives failed to frame it in this way. When we asked people, again, in the final survey of the election that we did, what's the single most important issue facing the country? That top line, it's hard to see on the screen there because the font's so small, says economy and jobs, 46%. In an open-ended question, no prompting, said it was related to either of those two issues. And when we asked people, which party do you think is best to handle that issue, the Conservatives actually had a 4-point advantage over the Liberals. So if the election was only about the economy, and only those people who thought the economy was the top issue voted, the Conservatives probably would have won, not a majority, but they might have won a minority government. Okay? The fact that 54% thought this election was something else, and almost all of them were not going to vote for the Conservatives, is the reason why they ultimately lost. So the election was about something else. So they weren't effective at either changing the desire for change or reframing the election around the economy. The second question to ask then is, were they able to ratchet up fear of change, right? Were they able to suggest that either of the alternatives, Mr. Mulcair and the New Democrats, Mr. Trudeau and the Liberals, were not credible alternatives to them? And we ask a question, and I won't go through all of it here, but we ask people, imagine if the NDP were to win. Do you think on a range of issues, things would get better, things would get worse, or would make no difference? And for the most part, right, we've never had a New Democrat government in Canada. You've had one for a long time here in Manitoba, but in most parts of the country, the NDP is either an afterthought or something we fear. If you live in Ontario, right, Bob Rae, I was 9 when he was elected premier, but for about half the province, they don't remember the NDP years as good ones. Similarly, in British Columbia, mixed views about the New Democrats, there was very little fear that Tom Mulcair and the NDP would make things worse, right? Only when it comes to keeping taxes low did a third of Canadians say the NDP, if elected, would make things worse. Most people actually believed either they would make things better or the plurality said, meh, no difference, which is its own issue, right? That almost half of the country says, if we have a New Democrat government, things really wouldn't change all that much. The same is true for the Liberals, right? By the end of the campaign, very few people believed that Justin Trudeau would make things worse when it comes to economic growth, our standing in the world, our safe from terrorism, or keeping taxes low, okay? So once again, the Conservatives were not able, at least on a policy front, to raise doubts about their two primary opponents. And I think they knew this. Right? This is only a smattering of publicly available polling. They were doing far more. And they probably realized that the only way that they were going to convince the country that the alternative was not credible was to question his personal ability to be prime minister as opposed to the policy questions that they were putting forward. And so we get what appeared to be, in the early days, a very effective ad campaign questioning whether Justin Trudeau was ready to be prime minister. How many of you in the audience had seen that ad? In some way, okay. My good friend was in charge of advertising for the Conservative campaign, and they spent a lot of money and put it on a lot of television programs that we all watch, right? If you watched the World Series, if you watched the NHL playoffs, they started this campaign. So if we look at what the effect of this ad was, and I think it was effective in the early days, right? These three lines represent the percentage of Canadians who have positive impressions of Mr. Mulcair, the orange line, Mr. Harper, the blue line, and Mr. Trudeau, the red line. And you can see that In about the fall of 2014, 39% of Canadians had a positive impression of Justin Trudeau. This was still over a year after he'd become leader. He was still the most popular leader in the country. Mr. Mulcair and Mr. Harper were basically quite a ways back. Within the span of about 8 months, we saw a significant deterioration in Mr. Trudeau's personal numbers. Right? People pretty much knew him. There was very few people who said, I don't know who Mr. Trudeau is. And we saw a shift. So numbers went from positive to negative. So if I showed you another chart of the negative numbers, you'd see the inverse, right? His negative numbers increased. At the same time, and I'll come back to Mr. Mulcair in a minute, we saw an improvement in Mr. Mulcair's numbers. But look at the course of the election. Okay, so the Conservatives were effective in bringing down Mr. Trudeau's numbers. But throughout the campaign, and I think this is one of the lessons of the campaign, is if you are going to define your opponent in a certain way, you better be sure he doesn't prove you wrong. And I think that's exactly what Prime Minister Trudeau did, is he proved to most Canadians that what the Conservatives were saying about him were not true, that in fact he was ready to be Prime Minister. And if we look specifically at Quebec, which I think was one of the most surprising results of the night, the fact that the Liberals won seats where majority of people voted yes in the 1995 referendum, we see that this is the net favorability for the leaders in Quebec. Mr. Harper has been unpopular in Quebec pretty much since his election in 2006. But you can see that Mr. Mulcair, despite what was a small collapse for the New Democrats and their support, which I'll come to in a moment, Mr. Trudeau was not overly popular in Quebec, but over the final weeks of the campaign had improved significantly to the point where he was almost as popular as Mr. Mulcair. Some other data that suggests the Conservative failed at raising questions about Mr. Trudeau. We ask in our survey for people to rate each of the leaders on a scale from 0 to 10, 0 meaning this word or phrase does not describe them well at all, to 10, this describes them well. And we ask, does the leader have good ideas, a leader is honest, understands people like you, accountable, willing to answer questions, and ready to be Prime Minister. One of the most fascinating things, which proves to me early on that the ads worked, is that Mr. Trudeau trailed both Mr. Harper and Mr. Mulcair on that ready to be Prime Minister question. By the end of the campaign, you can see that bottom line there, they were all tied. Okay? So Mr. Trudeau's numbers across the board improved significantly since August 15th, the beginning of the campaign. But perhaps the most important were a leader. He led even Mr. Harper by 4 points, and ready to be Prime Minister, he was tied with the three others. Okay, so at the end of the day, the Conservatives did not raise the doubts or fears about either of the alternatives. They tried to, but it didn't show up in public opinion. And so there was little fear of change, and as we'll see in a moment, Mr. Trudeau effectively countered that argument that he was not ready through his debate performances, through his advertising, and simply through his performance during the election campaign. He performed when people started to pay attention, and I think that was why he was so successful. If we look at the second campaign then, so the Conservatives, as a result of this, the best they probably could have done was win a minority government, right? Even if they had gotten fewer votes, there was lots of talk about the fact they could win more seats, and what would that mean for coalitions, and what would the Governor General do? Lots of discussion, and we'll come at the end of my presentation to talk potentially about the impact of polls themselves. You can all scold me later about how I'm destroying democracy, and I know there's a few people in the room who believe that. But that being said, the second campaign was about which of the two alternatives was the best agent for change, okay? Who was going to replace the Conservatives? And I start this discussion because a fascinating thing happened over the course of a few months, right? We often didn't look at it from this angle, but I think the media and pundits and those speaking publicly about elections, assumed that the NDP surge that we saw here, right, this is vote intentions. So out of nowhere, on May 2015, NDP support goes from the low to mid 20s to the low 30s, right, a 10-point boost, literally overnight. Almost the same as what happened when Mr. Trudeau became leader of the Liberal Party. Overnight, the Liberals became competitive again. So the question I ask is, was this NDP surge real? Was there actual a solid foundation behind it. One of the ways we tried to understand this was we asked Canadians, how well do you know the four main party leaders? And what we found was that most people had a pretty good sense of who Stephen Harper was. No surprise, he was prime minister for 10 years. Some people, about a third, admitted they didn't know too much or nothing about Justin Trudeau. But look at Mr. Mulcair, who had actually been leader of the New Democrats longer than Mr. Trudeau was leader of the Liberals, had been the leader of the opposition for a number of years. And this was asked at the beginning of the campaign. So this is actually at the point at which he was the most popular he had ever been and might ever be. Over 45% of Canadians said they either didn't know him very well or didn't know him at all. So this to me is a signal that what we think about him, what we imagine him to be, was not built on a solid foundation. That in fact, when the front pages of all our newspapers and newscasts on May, Brenda, what day was the Alberta election? Sorry to put you on the spot. May 5th, I think.
It was.
May 5th, right? Was, holy cow, Alberta just elected a new Democrat government, right? And I could have used a different word, but I won't because we're at this great bookstore. Holy cow, right? And I was in Ontario, I had friends in Atlantic Canada, people across the country, across, you know, if anyone outside of Canada followed Canadian politics, it was a shock. I was telling Dino, who's gonna be in the conference, he's from California, that it would be the equivalent of Bernie Sanders becoming governor of Texas. Right? So if Alberta could elect new Democrats, why couldn't we? And I think that explains part of this rise that we've seen. And the same rise in vote intentions was mirrored in how people felt about Mr. Mulcair. Literally overnight, people woke up and said, I like this guy. When we asked him, do you like him? Right? And those on the New Democrat side, those supporters of the New Democrats would say he had performed well in the House. He was the prosecutor in chief, all true. But one of the lessons that I always learn and have to remind myself living in Ottawa is that a lot of what happens in Ottawa doesn't leave Ottawa, right? So while he may be an amazing performer in the House of Commons, and all of you who are here tonight care probably a lot more about politics than the average Canadian, you may have noticed it, but most Canadians don't. So he was a good leader of the opposition, but that's not why his numbers went up 10 points. It was because the NDP shocked us all and made us consider voting NDP. What's most remarkable, and I'll show you some data later, is that at one point, at this peak, 63-64% of Canadians, 6 out of 10 said they'd consider voting for the NDP nationally, right? At no point in, we don't have tracking data, but I can promise you, at no point in the history of this country has 60% of Canadians said, I'm open to voting for the New Democrats. And that's what we saw as a result of that. But then, campaigns have a funny way of changing things. And there is a debate, and I'm sure political scientists will debate this, pollsters themselves, we debate this, the importance of the whole debate around the niqab and what happened during the election and whether or not it was what I believe a mortally wounding event for the New Democrats. When you look at public opinion data and you model it out, the niqab actually had very little independent effect on people's vote choice. People did not go into the ballot box saying, I am voting conservative or bloc in large numbers, or whether in Quebec or outside of Quebec, because of a party's position on the niqab. But what I believe it did is it completely disrupted the campaign. It threw the New Democrats off their game. It opened people's minds, particularly in Quebec, to voting for a different party. Okay? So this one issue had that effect. We asked a question during the campaign that asked people for their preference. Now, if you don't know the backstory, the Conservatives had brought in a policy that said a woman must show her face, or anyone, not just a woman, anyone has to show their face during a public citizenship ceremony. And they, which at that point you didn't have to. You could, in private, show your face and then wear, if you are a Muslim woman and you wear a niqab or a burqa, you could wear that in public and take the oath. They said you could not do that. At the middle of the campaign, around September 15th, a federal court ruled that that rule, that policy was unlawful, right? That they could not force women to do that. Not because it's a charter right, but simply because that law was not legal. And I'm not a lawyer, so I won't go into the details about it. But it forced party leaders to respond. And it opened a door for the Bloc Québécois and the Conservatives to use that issue as a wedge, because as this data shows, almost the majority of Canadians believed, and we asked the question in a slightly more subtle way than some of the other pollsters, we asked, which of these comes closest to your personal preference? That a woman or anyone should have to show their face during a public ceremony, even if they had previously shown their established their identity in private with an immigration official. Even under that condition, 48% of Canadians said yes, in a public citizenship ceremony, you have to show your face. Which was one of the interesting, I think, reflections of Canadian public opinion, right? We often think of ourselves as incredibly tolerant and multicultural, but here was an issue that I think shocked a lot of people. In Quebec, 64% had that view, sharply different than the rest of the country. 47% said, I'm willing to accept someone covering their face in a public ceremony as long as they establish their identity in private, and 5% said, I don't care, do whatever you want, right? You don't have to do any of that. And you can see the difference on the left side of your screen between Ontario, Quebec, and British Columbia, right? Almost the complete opposites of how they viewed it. And you can see how supporters of the four main parties viewed it. So a majority of Liberals, a majority of New Democrats felt supported the second option, the more compromising option. 84% of Bloc Québécois supporters believe that women should have to show their face regardless in a citizenship ceremony. So this was an incredibly divisive issue. It was incredibly a powerful wedge. And if we look specifically at Quebec, again, I said 64% held that uncompromising view. And among those who held that view, you can see the vote across that where that row with the one. 29% voted for the Bloc, 26 voted for the Liberals and 18 for the Conservatives. This tells me, again, that it wasn't a ballot question. That just as many people voted for the two parties that actually hold the position they are opposed to, despite that fact, right? What I think it did, and the public opinion data is clear, and pollsters, again, will argue about this, but unless you have a better explanation for why the NDP dropped 20 points in 1 week after this ruling came out, and they don't, in my opinion, then this has to be a major factor. And if you ask New Democrats who worked on the campaign, they themselves will say they heard it in the phone calls, they heard it in the ID, particularly in Quebec. So you can see in public polling, this is not just ours, in all polling, if you average what was happening in Quebec, between basically September 15th and the end of the month, within 2 weeks, the party dropped over 15 points in the polls in Quebec, largely to the benefit of the Bloc and the Conservatives, who took the opposite position on that issue. So this issue, I think, had an effect at destabilizing the New Democrats, right? And completely shaking people's view, particularly in Quebec, about Tom Mulcair and the New Democrats. So then the question became, and this is, I think, the fundamental question of the campaign for the alternatives, was who can beat Stephen Harper? And what we found was that New Democrat expectations, people, when we asked them, who do you think is going to win the election? And up until basically the last weekend, my view is this is a better reflection of public opinion than asking people how they're going to vote. When you ask people, who do you think is going to win the election? This is the trend line back from August 14th. You can see for a long time, people thought the Liberals were going to win. Just like impressions of Mr. Mulcair, just like vote intention, you see that spike in the orange line around the time of the Alberta election. But basically, in the last 3 weeks of the campaign, this is across the country, not just in Quebec, people no longer believed the NDP would win. And it was a signal, and this is where polls do influence elections, and the way the media covered the election was, no longer was Mr. Mulcair in this, right? And so if you are a voter, one of those 60% who say, I definitely want a change in government, and I no longer believe Mr. Mulcair can do it, you're going to start moving to another alternative. And so these two lines show the percentage of people who say they're going to vote NDP, along with the percentage who say they think the NDP is going to win. So they're related, but it's not a perfect relationship, right? So there is a difference. And you can see that even though, and this is the lasting effect of Mr. Mulcair, he's still relatively popular in Quebec, despite the fact that only 12% thought the NDP would win, they still had 26% of the vote in the province, okay? So they were still able to hold some of that support, but you can see those lines moved in the same direction. And perhaps the most interesting finding, when you ask people who say they definitely want change, who are you going to vote for? This is the trend line, okay? So back in April in 2015, it was basically split 50-50 between the Liberals and the New Democrats. Over the course of the spring and summer into the fall, you could see at its peak, 51% of those who said they definitely wanted change were going to vote NDP. This was at their zenith. They hit the high mark. Over the course of the campaign, that number dropped. By the end, the opposite was true. Half of those who said they were going to vote, definitely wanted change, were going to vote for Mr. Trudeau. And the NDP were able to salvage a third of that vote. Okay? So an amazing shift in a cohort and a segment of the electorate that was going to decide this election, right? Was either going to give Mr. Harper a minority by splitting the vote, or was going to at some point, as we all said would happen, although based on no evidence, that eventually the country would coalesce around one of the two options, which is exactly what they did. And I believe it was largely because of two factors. One was the NAQUB in Quebec, which accelerated the decline of the New Democrats outside of Quebec, and also because of the performance of Mr. Trudeau. Okay, so at the same, you can't take credit away from him. He performed well. He did very well and surprised many of us with his performance. And I think those two factors led to the success of the Liberals. So to sum up then my assessment of the campaign, Conservatives did not dent the desire for change, nor did they raise doubts about their opponents. And as a result, they would have a very difficult time winning this election. But on the other campaign that we saw, the Liberals presented a more appealing version of change. And we have lots of data if you haven't seen it. One of the great things about polls is we can actually, and we've tried to do this at Abacus, is go beyond the horse race numbers and try to understand. And it was shocking. We asked a question, which sometimes I'm amazed that Canadians pay as much attention as they do. We asked people, who do you think of Mr. Mulcair or Mr. Trudeau? And we asked this about halfway through the campaign, represents moderate change versus ambitious change, okay? And people used to say the New Democrats are Liberals in a hurry, right? In this election, the Liberals were Democrats in a hurry, and people recognized it. Mr. Trudeau came far ahead of Mr. Mulcair when it came to who people thought represented ambitious change, change that you would feel quickly, right? And this was a strategic success for the Liberals in being able to position themselves in such a way. So a number of factors affected it, but I think the Liberals certainly were able to coalesce those change voters. So I've got about 12 minutes, so I want to take some, what are some of my lessons from this? And some of it doesn't completely connect back to what I just said, because I think there's lots of lessons to learn from the election, and I only had a few minutes to talk about them. But the first is, I am a firm believer that we are not as rigid in our political orientations as many assume. Okay, so if you study political science in this room and you've taken a political behaviors class, and I teach at Carleton the same thing, we tell our students, you know, we debate whether party identification is strong, whether people have ideologies. There is, I think, a growing sense that we are less, we identify less with political parties, at least firmly, and that we can, our ideological, if ideology even exists, aren't held as firmly anymore. And I've got a few points sort of to defend that. I mentioned earlier, when we asked the question, would you even consider voting for the political parties? And this is the trend lines since the beginning of 2015, and you can see large numbers of Canadians are open to voting NDP, they're open to voting Liberal. Certainly part of the reason the Conservatives